Welcome to Senadhipan Education Foundation again. Education is the key to unlocking the world, a passport to freedom. He started this educational program way back in 2012 by releasing a set of educational DVDs by none other than Sion Han Kim at Taj Vivanda, Trivandrum. And it was distributed free of cost. And we started 6 months and 1 year fellowship program in basic and advanced laparoscopic surgeries way back in 2007. And the brochure was released by none other than Professor Antonio Longo, the inventor of stapler hemorrhoidectomy from Italy. We conduct hands-on training in dry lab and wet lab. And with the advent of COVID, we started online programs to educate the surgeons. And the logo of Senadhipan Education Foundation was released by none other than Dr. Palani Velu.
And a good friend of mine, and since he started laparoscopy, we're very happy about it. Dear friends, Parvinder Lal, Vice President of National Board Examination.
And then onwards, we started having live surgeries in online platform. We did our first Facebook Live in April 2020. And we did a lab people in YouTube Live in August 2020. And the link was shared to the members of Senadhipan Education Foundation. And we used to conduct live lectures with the world leaders in the respective fields, and we started giving e-certificate also. We have almost 10 WhatsApp groups in social media to distribute the link. And we have the YouTube link, Senadhipan Education Foundation. And all the webinar videos are available in the YouTube link. And we have got a Facebook group also. In the first series, we conducted 28 webinars, absolutely free for the aspiring surgeons from the entire world. And we have got very good global acceptance. Mostly more than 50 countries participate at a time. This is supposed to be one of the largest virtual platforms in the world. The last meeting, we had 1,303 participants from more than 56 countries. And the YouTube link is available free for the webinars and the videos. Last time we had a speaker from Delhi, Professor Anil Agarwal, talked about radical cholecystectomy. It was moderated by Professor V.K. Kapoor. And in the direct participation itself, more than 412 participants were there. And indirect participants were nearly 700. So total 1,100 participants were there for the last webinar. And this time, we have two stalwarts in the field of hepatobiliary surgery. You all know them. Dr. Sadiq Sikora needs no introduction at all. And Professor T.D. Yadav also needs no introduction to this audience. Dr. Sadiq Sikora is the Director of Surgical Services, Institute of Digestive Hepatopancreatobiliary Sciences, Sacra World Hospital, Bangalore, India. Actually, he has got a very good academic career. Actually, he completed his MBBS and MS from All India Institute of Medical Science with many gold medals in the field. And he has got a fellowship in Royal College of Surgeons, Glasgow 2011. Got the fellowship of American College of Surgeons 2001. Got the traveling fellowship of Japan Surgical Society 2000. He was visiting faculty to University of Tsukuba, Japan in 2001. She has got a fellowship in surgical oncology which took from University of Pittsburgh, and he is has got another fellowship, International Cancer Research and Technology Transfer Fellowship of UICG. And he is actually ex-secretary of ISPBA. He was honorary secretary of ISPBA in 2013 to 2017. He is a reviewer of many journals like European Journal of Surgical Oncology, Journal of Gastroenterology and Hepatology, Annals of Surgery, Journal of Pancreatic Surgery. And he is also the editorial board member of Journal of Gastroenterology and Hepatology, World Journal of Gastrointestinal Surgery, member of International Task to Formulate Consensus Guidelines for Preventing Bile Duct Injury. With these words, I invite Dr. Sadiq Salim Sikora to Senarvan Education Foundation. Now we have Dr. Srijaya Srish to introduce our moderator. She is the Associate Professor of Department of Gastroenterology, Medical College, Trivandrum. Over to Srijaya, please unmute your mic.
Thank you, Dr. Baiju. And good evening, everybody. It's my proud privilege to introduce Professor Thakur Deen Yadav, or Professor TDY, as he's fondly known in PGI. He's the Professor of General Surgery, PGIMER, Chandigarh. He did his MBBS from Allahabad University, MS from Allahabad University, DNB. Then he was senior resident in surgical gastroenterology in STPG at Lucknow. He's also a diplomate from the world-renowned Karolinska Institute, Stockholm, Sweden. There's a long list of awards and academic courses to his credit. I'll just mention a few. He was a surgical fellow at the Asian Center for Liver Disease and Transplantation, Singapore. He is trained in basic and advanced microvascular surgery from the National University Hospital, Singapore. He has a fellowship in organ transplantation from the Karolinska Institute, Sweden. He's also a visiting professor at St. James Academic Hospital, Leeds, UK, at the Department of HPP Surgery and Liver Transplantation, Johns Hopkins, USA, the Department of Organ Transplantation. He has more than 60 publications to his credit, 9 chapters in books. He has invited lectures in various national and international conferences. He's the honorary secretary of ISPBA, and he's the organizing secretary of various conferences in PGI. He has actively participated in one of the successful liver transplant programs in government sector in India. He's actively involved in the liver transplantation in PGI Chandigarh. So, hearty welcome, sir.
Thank you, Srijaya, for the nice introduction of the moderator. Welcome, Dr. T.D. Yadav, to this forum. Before starting the program, I request all the participants to mute their mic on entry. If possible, kindly acknowledge their name by renaming their device. Participants logging from outside India are requested to reveal their identity in the chat box so that the host can acknowledge them. Raise your hand if you want to intervene in between the talk or session. Everybody will be given permission to unmute their mic if they want to speak something after the session. If you are on a portable device, please mute your audio and hide your video while moving. Please mute or hide your video if you are not in a casual dress even. The next webinar is going to happen next week by none other than Dr. Mohan Ramachandani. He is the Director of Interventional Endoscopy, Asian Institute of Gastroenterology. It will be moderated by Dr. Rajesh Puri, Director of Institute of Hepatopancreatobiliary Sciences, Medanta Medicity, Gurgaon, India. The link will be shared to the chat box, and the reminder to join for the webinar will be given in the WhatsApp group. So if you want to contact us, you can write to us senadhiman@gmail.com, and I welcome the moderator and the speaker to this show. I request Dr. T.D. Yadav to take the proceedings forward.
So very good evening, and thanks Dr. Baiju to give this opportunity for us to be here today. And I personally feel, and I think everybody would agree, that it's a great effort to run a educational program. It's a great social service to run an educational program for the benefit of the people who are ready to learn. And for that matter, it becomes more important when there is no financial burden to the people who are learning. So I am honored to be here today in this program, and it gives me immense pleasure that today our teacher, Dr. Sadiq Salim Sukora, who is going to talk about colorectal cyst management. And I am sure he is going to give all the tricks and tips of the successful management of a colorectal cyst. Our job is that we will try to, in a combined way, to try to discuss all the tricky points in this short time, whatever is available to us. And then I will try to take the questions which are in the box. And some questions, I find something which is sir has not covered, then we will discuss more. So I welcome Dr. Sadiq Salim Sikora, and then we can discuss when he finishes his talk. And thanks once again, Sadiq sir.
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah. Good evening. Thank you very much for the kind introduction, Dr. Baiju. And as Dr. T.D. has said, that it's indeed a great thing what you're doing. And it's really impressive the kind of audience you've been able to generate and the type of activities which you are conducting. So I congratulate you.
Thank you. I've
been here before, and it's always a pleasure to come back here and join this forum and do my bit in any which way possible. I'm glad T.D. Yadav is here. We go a long way. We know that he has special interest in this. And I think between both of us, we should be able to take this forward and hopefully impart some messages at the end of it, which would help people to manage, diagnose, and manage these patients. So the way I'm going to conduct this is the outline of my talk, which is going to be, so the first and foremost is, how do we diagnose? And the dilemma whether the dilated bile duct is colorectal cyst or it's just a dilated bile duct. We'll talk a bit on the classification and a critical analysis of the classification, the imaging and assessment of the patients with colorectal cyst, surgical strategy, what to adopt, what are the important pointers and processes that you undertake while treating patients with colorectal cysts, what are the outcomes. Of course, the laparoscopic approach is important, and where it stands and what my views are on that. And at the end, we'll do a malignancy in colorectal cysts with a summary at the end of it. So way back in 1723, Water described colorectal cyst. We know that in the Far East, the incidence of colorectal cyst is quite high as compared to the West. And we fall somewhere in between in this divide from the West and Far East. It's more prevalent in females, and most are diagnosed before age 10 years. One of the critical things about colorectal cyst is its association with the abnormal pancreaticobiliary ductal union, which is present in a variable percentage from 1/3 to 2/3 of patients with colidocal cysts, and we'll discuss much more about that. So whenever we are discussing about colidocal cysts, actually, invariably the issue comes is, when do we call it a dilated bile duct versus a colidocal cyst? Let's look at dilated bile duct. And again, there is a whole list of things which is written, the change in diameter with age and elderly people having larger diameter and so on and so forth. We know that the bile duct size or width varies with age, but majority of the people have a bile duct diameter less than 7 millimeter. So if a bile duct diameter is more than 7 millimeter, it should be considered as dilated. And this is a very interesting study that on ultrasound, when you have a dilated bile duct more than 7 millimeter and no symptoms, and if these, out of these 49 underwent of the 77, 60% had various lesions which needed review and treatment. So bile duct more than 7 millimeter may have an etiology which needs treatment. The ones which are followed up had no problems on follow-up, but those who were evaluated with CT, again, 50% had identifiable lesions. So the message which comes out is that if the bile duct is dilated more than 7 millimeter, it needs evaluation, and majority of the times you would find a cause. How would you call it a colidocal cyst vis-a-vis a dilated bile duct? So let's look at this. Here's a patient, post-cholecystectomy, history of recurrent bile duct stones, multiple ERCPs done, and then eventually a CBD exploration and a T-tube drainage was done. And what we have is a T-tube cholangiogram after about 6 weeks in this patient. So you see the configuration of the duct, T-tube is present there. And then on the other hand, there is another post-cholecystectomy patient with a residual gallbladder with multiple stones in the bile duct. And these are also recurrent CBD stones. So out of these, which one is a dilated bile duct secondary to CBD stones? Which one is a colidocal cyst? And if you look at this and look at the features, when you look that there is asymmetric dilatation between the intrahepatic and the extrahepatic bile duct, the shape and configuration of the dilatation, and the fact that there is persistent dilatation after drainage by a T-tube suggests that this one is a colidocal cyst and this one is a bile duct, a dilated bile duct with CBD stones. So these are some of the features which help us decide whether it is a dilated bile duct or a colidocal cyst. So let's look at the major criteria. The key word is asymmetrical dilatation of extrahepatic vis-a-vis the intrahepatic bile ducts. Generally, if the diameter is more than 10 millimeter without any obstructive etiology, there is an abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union associated. And if these patients have had dilatation or drainage of the biliary system, there is persistent dilatation as opposed to resolution of the dilatation following drainage. And there are some minor criteria like a dilated GB with distended patent cystic ducts. And if there are stones present in the CBD, there are usually non-impacted stones, and usually you have sludge in the gallbladder stones and in gallbladder instead of well-formed stones. We come next to another important association, which is abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union, which is a union outside the duodenal wall with a long common channel. The normal length is up to 5 millimeter. Anything more than 15 millimeter is considered abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union, and it invariably takes place outside the wall. Generally, about 22 to 28 millimeter length of abnormal ductal union is seen. And this is present variable in reports, but up to 70% of colidocal cysts will have abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union. It is important not only to know whether it is an abnormal union, but the type of union. And you will see consistently when we are talking about the treatment of these patients, how this has an impact on the treatment. So it's not very complicated. It's very simple to understand. Basically, this was given by Comey in 1992. What it says is type 1, wherein the bile duct opens into the pancreatic duct and is called the BP union. And this is usually at right angle. And this, the two ones, A and B, are with a terminal dilatation, ectatic dilatation. Type 2 is a PB union, wherein the pancreatic duct joins the bile duct and it is at an acute angle. And again, B is a terminal ectatic segment. Just remember BP and PB, right angle and acute angle union, and it has bearing on the treatment. The type 3 is not very common, less than 10%, and basically it is associated with the pancreas division and various combinations of abnormal pancreatic papillary ductal union. One of the Japanese surveys, if you look, when there is a choledochal cyst, the commonest type of pancreatic papillary ductal abnormality is type 1 variety, whereas when there are non-dilated ducts, it is the type 2 variety which is more prevalent, although the other ones are also present in about 1/3 of patients. So when you look at the MRI, this is the classical BP variety at right angle, this is joining, as opposed to an acute angle with a terminal ectatic segment as a type 2. So it's important for us to know what is the nature of whether there is abnormal pancreatic papillary ductal union and what type is it. You can see that when you look at these abnormal union versus the normal union, with the abnormal union, more often people or patients or children will have pancreatitis and inflammation. And when you look at malignancy, it is seen in about 10%, and abnormal union is seen in about 70% of these patients, with type 1 being more common than the type 2 variety. So there is an association of malignancy as a risk factor with choledochal cysts, and the type 1 variety is more common than the type 2 variety. I would like you to also look at the formae frustae choledochal cyst. Now, formae frustae is that it doesn't have the typical features. It is seen in about 1/5 up to 1/5, but it's usually less than 10%. The biliary dilatation is not much. There are associated with biliary or pancreatic symptoms, usually seen in children. So when you have a non-dilated or not as dilated as you would expect in a choledochal cyst with an abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union with typical symptoms, these children usually will need treatment, which is excision of the bile duct and hepaticogegenostomy. Now in Far East and in Japan, these are also seen in adults, and therein their common recommendation is to for patients to undergo a cholecystectomy because of the high incidence of gallbladder cancer in patients with a formae frustae variety. Let's get to the classification of choledochal cyst. Now, way back, Alonso and Lech talked about this three type, which is cystic dilatation of extrahepatic bile duct, diverticular type, and choledochocele. Subsequently, Todani came up with a more detailed classification. And basically, this is a nice pie chart to understand what it means. Basically, when the abnormality lies in common bile duct in terms of a diverticulum or an intraduodenal diverticulum, it is type 2 and 3. I'll come to detail. When it is extrahepatic completely or extra plus intrahepatic, it is the one which are most common and which we will be dealing with today in our talk. And the third component is the intrahepatic part, which is called the Caroli disease or the Caroli syndrome when it is associated with congenital hepatic fibrosis. I'm not going to talk too much about these variety and the type 5 variety, but concentrate mainly on the extrahepatic ductal variety of choledochal cyst. So let's look at it a little more in detail. The Todani classification type 1 has been divided into A, B, and C type, basically based on the configuration. If it's a cystic type, it's type A, a segmental dilatation type B of the main duct, and a fusiform dilatation, which is the most common, which is diffuse and cylindrical, type 1C, which is one of the common varieties. So this is how you will see the asymmetrical dilatation, not that much dilatation of the bile duct, extrahepatic bile duct dilated with a common abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union. This is the type 4 variety, which is the second most common one. The type 4A is multiple intra and extrahepatic duct. So you can see here on the MRCP, the large extrahepatic dilatation. And you can see that there are multiple intrahepatic dilatation extending into the secondary order branches with abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union. There is a type 4B where there are multiple extrahepatic duct only. As you can see in this MRCP, that there are two segments which are dilated with a normal segment in between. It is quite uncommon and we don't see very many of these. Then you have the typical type 2, which is a diverticulum, as you can see here, and a type 3, which is a terminal part intraduodenal dilatation, which is a cholecystocele. Type 5, as we said, is the Carolis disease, which can be unilateral or bilateral with a Carolis syndrome with congenital hepatic fibrosis. There's one type C, which has been associated and described, wherein the cystic duct is also dilated and ectatic, and it's been labeled associated with or without an extrahepatic ductal dilatation as type C, type 6. What is critical is to sometimes to differentiate type 1C with type 4A. Type 1C, which is a fusiform variety, basically can extend to the intrahepatic ducts, and it is a contiguous upstream dilatation. It may or may not have an abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union. The critical thing is when you excise the extrahepatic duct, the intrahepatic dilatation resolves when you follow up this patient. In contrast, the type 4A variety, you invariably have hilar or umbilical stricture in this patient, as you can see here, which is characterized by an abrupt caliber change. And these are due to either membranous or septal strictures, single or multiple, unilateral or bilateral. We'll talk about the management of each one of these. Now, there are some issues about this classification. Although it talks about the anatomy of the configuration of the cholecystocele, it doesn't take into account the symptoms or complications. I think it has a bearing on how you manage these patients. So it should be incorporated at some stage. And age should also be a consideration, because based on the age, sometimes you take decisions of how to treat these patients. Also, the inclusion of presence of abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union is not mentioned in the classical Todani classification. And there is no mention of the laterality, especially in type 4A variety. So I suggest or propose that you should have type 1, which is A, B, and C, cystic or fusiform, APBDU present or absent, with symptoms, asymptomatic or complications, and type 4A with abnormal union, unilateral or bilateral, which is extent of the abnormal ducts unilaterally or bilaterally, because it has bearing in the treatment. What we need in deciding and planning the management is a good imaging. What we need to see in imaging is, first and foremost, as we discussed, to differentiate between a dilated bile duct and a cholecystocele cyst. If it is a cholecystocele cyst, as we discussed earlier, what is, as per the classification, which type is it, whether APBDU is present or not. The other significant thing is often there is presence of abnormal biliary anatomy and union, which you have to be prepared and look for, and sometimes it is missed with significant dilatation and maybe a result of missing out these ducts in draining, resulting in post-operative complications. We've also seen that there are vascular anomalies associated in cholecystocyte cysts, and that is important in management because if it leads to injury of these vessels, if they are not documented earlier or you're not aware of, or you may have to deal with them when you're resecting the cholecystocyte cyst. And whether there is malignancy, especially in the adult population and elderly, whether there is malignancy in the cholecystocyte cyst, because the treatment of that is different. So the cholangiogram which we need, and earlier we used to believe that ERCP is the thing which we need to document the anatomy, the configuration, and the abnormal pancreatic biliary ductal union. But with an MR cholangiogram and with good quality that we can get, you can document all of these on an MR cholangiogram. Another thing, especially in children, so we need to look at doing an intraoperative cholangiogram, because in children, the cystic variety is quite common. It overlies when you do an MR on the intrapancreatic area, and you may have difficulty in defining abnormal pancreatic biliary ductal union. And sometimes it's difficult to get a good MR cholangiogram in children. So an intraoperative cholangiogram may be useful in defining the very things which we are talking about on a cholangiogram. And this one study clearly says in pediatric cholecystocyte cyst, basically a combination of MR and intraoperative cholangiogram is the best sort of combination of investigation which provides you with all the information. So once you have all this information, diagnosis, anatomy, and various other things which you want to know about this, we get on to the management of cholecystocyte cysts. When do we advise surgery? So all cholecystocyte cysts, when diagnosed, should undergo a complete excision, and a high Hiler hepaticogegastomy should be performed in all patients. Some exceptions are in elderly asymptomatic. Now we are seeing a lot of patients with dilated bile ducts post 60, 65, 70 years with no obstructive lesion after complete evaluation, and we diagnose them as being having cholecystocyte cysts. And often the question posed is, do they need surgery? So it is something which you will have to discuss with the patient, and based on any symptoms, fitness of the patient, and whether what is the risk status for this patient to undergo this surgery. And there is a case can be made out to observe these individuals if they don't have any symptoms, and if they have certainly conditions which preclude them to undergo this surgery. In children, I'm going to not concentrate on that in this talk and mainly talk about adults, but in neonatal, now we are pediatric surgeons are doing at all ages, but wait till adequate weight of this child is there for a child to undergo surgery without any complications. So the strategy is very clear. You need to do a complete excision of the extrahepatic and the part which is extending into the intrapancreatic part, especially in the type 1 variety. And in the type 4 variety, apart from excising the intrapancreatic and extrahepatic part, you need to deal with the dilatation, the segmental dilatation, by way of taking care of the web and stenosis which are present in this, and I'll show this in the video. It is very critical to take care of this. And I will tell you some of the problems which we face when people undertake these in laparoscopic procedures. You need to, may require to do an intraoperative cholangiogram if you don't have all the anatomy clear in the operating at the time of MR cholangiogram. And sometimes you may have to do a cholecystoscopy and clearance of the debris from the terminal part, especially if there is a acute angle union and you cannot go very much down on the bile duct. The key is to establish a wide bilioentric mucosa to mucosa anastomosis. And I say that we should not be doing an end-to-side hepaticogegastomy, but a side-to-side hepaticogegastomy. The common question which is posed always is the lower end, how low to go. So you need, the cholangiogram is the key. You need to know the configuration of the cyst, if it is cystic or fusiform. Because if it is cystic, you'll get a very clear delineation with the dilated and the normal part, and you need to reach up to there. Fusiform, it may be sometimes difficult, and you need to see the abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union. The type 1, which is the BP type, where right angle, you can go right down to the union of the biliary to the pancreatic. Whereas in type 2, you have to be careful how low you go so that you don't injure the entry of the pancreatic duct into the union. So you have to identify this transition from dilated to narrow part. And complete excision is the key. So as you can see here, if you have a colitocal cyst like this, you will very quickly get to this and there is no problem in identifying it. Whereas when you have a cyst like this, then you will have to divide the cyst lower end over here before it joins the pancreatic duct and clear these debris with a colidocoscope so that this is cleared and is not the cause of persistent symptoms. So these are some examples. You can see a cystic dilatation and a narrowed part. So you can get there, and this is the intrapancreatic part. This is in a child. You can see a huge cyst with a narrowed segment. And this is a fusiform variety, but you can see the transition to the narrow side, and you can know that you have reached the appropriate point at the lower end. So let me just show one small video of about 2 minutes to see how we do this dissection. So this is the head end, this is the foot end, surgeon view, you can see the colidocus has been looped by the sling, and this is the pancreas, you can see. Intrapancreatic CBD is being dissected with the sling around the colidocus. So I usually use just bipolar cautery. There's a very nice plane that you can see between the pancreas and the colidocus. And you need to just go patiently to dissect this intrapancreatic part. You have already seen the anatomy. You know that this is a fusiform variety, and you have to reach up to the part where there is an abnormal union. Sometimes you may use a CUSA for this dissection, but bipolar is good enough. One of the concerns when you do this dissection is where you are prepared to see the common union. Now that is important. This is one of the small vascular tributaries which may be there, venous tributaries, which you have to take. Be careful at the anteromedial part of the dissection, because that's where the pancreatic duct will join. So you have to be careful about that. So once you do this, take care of all the hemostasis while you are doing, and you can see that a significant portion of the intrapancreatic part has been dissected. Now we are happy that we have gone close down, low down enough to do the transection. Proximal end is tied off, the suture, and the distal end is transfixed with a PDS suture. Do a secure closure of the lower end. I like to run it down so that there is a secure closure of the lower end. You don't need to close the area of the pancreas which you have dissected. And we've not had any problems after that from the lower end till in all my experience of colidocal cysts. The proximal one has to be dealt with. The left duct is being opened up, as you can see. This is a fusiform variety. And once you do that, fine monofilament sutures, the classic Lungard-Kelly technique of hepaticogenostomy, I do in most of these patients with fine monofilament 5-0 or 6-0 sutures. So the whole duct is exposed. Now we have completed the posterior layer in this by interrupted sutures. And here is a completed anterior layer and a complete wide hepaticogenostomy. Now, do you always have to go very low down? No. When you have a type 2 union, like I said, acute union, a PB type of union, where there is significant pericolidocitis and inflammation, then you have to be smart enough, you open the cyst towards the lower end, look from inside, burn the mucosa, and then you can take a purse string suture from inside as low as you can to occlude the duct. As far as proximal limit of transection is concerned, always transect higher or higher. Now, when you do that, sometimes there are abnormal anomalies, as I told. So transect below the confluence and then tailor the proximal duct as per the anatomy that you get. Sometimes you can get multiple stoma. In type 4A, you deal with the strictures and stenosis, and I'll show you in a video. I do effacement of these openings, dilate the webs. These are very flimsy membranous strictures which are present, which can be dilated. And if there are stenosis, you need to just do a septoplasty in those patients. In type 4 variety, if it is unilocular and extending onto one side, especially the left side, then you may have an option of doing a left hepatectomy if there is significant intrahepatic dilatation with intrahepatic strictures. So this is what it should go right up. You should be able to see all the openings here. And we know that from the data available that hilar anastomosis has low HJ stricture rate versus the conventional common hepatic duct end-to-side anastomosis. And this we came to know long back since then. And sometimes you may have these two anastomoses, and I like to call this the owl's eye view. And you should always get an owl's eye view at the hilum to know that you've gone high enough and you are seeing all the ducts. And then you do a typical Bloomgard-Skelly or a continuous hepaticogeognostomy. Now this is one very nice paper from SGPGI when I was there by Dr. Richa Lal, she's the pediatric surgeon, talking about variations in biliary ductal and vascular anatomy and the relevance in management of colidocal cysts. So when you look at this MR, you can see that right posterior is draining separately and the right anterior and confluence is separate. And if you don't recognize this and you just transect here, you may miss this and land up with a small duct here, which is unidentified and may be a cause for postoperative bleed. And if you see this at this time, you need to be able to tailor the surgery accordingly. So either you transect it here, you have two ducts, and then you do two separate anastomoses, or you put these two ducts together and make a single anastomosis after a ductoplasty here. So you need to identify them, plan the surgery, and see whether you can make a single anastomosis or you need to do a multiple anastomosis. Sometimes when the duct is very small and you don't want and far, you don't want a single anastomosis, you may leave a roof of this over here and use this as a wide stoma in these patients. The second thing is vascular anatomy. This is seen in about 10 to 15% of patients. And generally the right hepatic artery runs anterior to the cyst and it creates a problem, especially if patients have had cholangitis, it is stuck to the cyst. And if you don't identify it, you may divide it inadvertently. So you need to dissect it off the cyst and reposition it posterior so as to dissect off and excise the extrahepatic bile duct. Also, sometimes the aberrant right hepatic artery you should be aware of, because if there is pericholecystitis, you may injure the abnormal right hepatic artery and lead to problems in the postoperative period. So what are the results and complications of this surgery? So usually you should have excellent long-term results. 95% success have been reported. Early complications are bile leak, pancreatitis, especially when you're handling the lower end, bleeding, adhesive obstruction, or wound complications. Late complications are varying, anastomotic stricture, proximal stone formation. Sometimes there is pancreatitis, especially associated with a type B APBDU, and follow-up malignancy. Late complications you have to pay attention to. Now, this is a very nice study in 2012, pediatric journal. You know, when you do a subhilar anastomosis, vis-a-vis a hilar anastomosis with ductplasty. So in this group A subhilar anastomosis, you see a high incidence of late complications, about 20%, and majority of these are due to HJ stricture, and they result in cholangitis, intrahepatic stones, residual intrapancreatic cysts, pancreatitis. Whereas hilar anastomosis and duct pasty have rest late complications of less than 5%. And these complications are also not related to the biliary system, but more of intestinal obstruction which required resurgery. So the million-dollar question is, how important is complete excision? And without doubt, all the extrahepatic component which has to be excised should be excised, because incomplete excision of lower end leads to residual stone, sludge, pancreatitis, and we've seen malignancy in the residual intrapancreatic part. An incomplete excision of the proximal part leads to anastomotic strictures with stasis and cholangitis. And of course, there is risk of malignancy. So you can see this. Here is a patient. You can see a good hepaticogenostomy being done, but there is a significant intrapancreatic cystic component which has been left behind, which has a mass on follow-up, which is malignancy developing in the residual cyst. This is another patient with a significant intrapancreatic component. The proximal part has been taken care of. HJ is fine, but a large intrapancreatic component is present. And this paper highlights this, that if you have a complete excision, only about 1% of patients had symptoms on long-term follow-up. Whereas partial excision, almost 2/3 of patients had symptoms and 14% has cancer in the remnant. So if you find that there is a remnant colidocal cyst in the intrapancreatic part, it warrants a resection because of the risk of development of cancer in the remnant part. Now quickly, two aspects I will cover, open versus laparoscopic excision. Now this is the in thing, and we know that laparoscopic excision has been accepted as a modality of treatment for colidocal cysts. It has been mostly reported suitable for children and in type 1 colidocal cysts. Very few reports and small number of patients in this series with type 4, because I think type 4 is a big problem. Type 4 patients need a lot of planning, dealing with the intrahepatic cyst, and you cannot take it lightly. Also, I think there is an issue about dealing with the intrapancreatic segment, especially if there is a significant component which is dilated intrapancreatic, and there is a history of cholangitis, which precludes a very good dissection of the intrapancreatic part. And there are issues about long-term results of HJ in these patients. So there are several systematic review and meta-analysis, and we know what the results of laparoscopic excision is, and there is no doubt about that. It has longer operative time, but shorter hospital duration and quicker recovery of bowel function, less late of intraoperative transfusion and intestinal obstruction. And there is no difference between bile leak, bleed, and pancreatitis between laparoscopic and open. But Dr. Stringer made this comment, and I think it is the crux of the whole argument. Is laparoscopic management of colidocal cysts the keyhole view missing the big picture? And my issues with that is that you need a significant expertise and caseload to be able to do these well. You have to be aware of the difficulties which you can encounter in distal colidocus management, the intrapancreatic part. The proximal anastomosis, and to be very honest, most of the time I have seen on all laparoscopic surgeries that it is an end-to-site hepaticogenostomy which is invariably performed. And I have seen injuries caused to portal vein, hepatic artery, especially in patients with difficulty in dissection of the colidocus in that situation. And most of the pediatric series prefer doing a hepaticodiagnostomy over a hepaticogenostomy. We can discuss, I have not addressed this issue here, but we can discuss this in the discussion. One of the key things which has come out is there is a learning curve in laparoscopic surgery. And this article lays down as 37 cases as a learning curve to reduce operative time, decrease complications, and length of hospital stay. And this paper talks of the biliary symptoms on long-term follow-up. So there were 30 patients which are managed, all had to undergo redo HJ, and seven of them or one-fourth had to have a hepatic artery reposition. So remember I told you it may go anterior. And if it is anterior, you avoid excising the complete choledochus extrahepatic part. So you leave behind that and it results in HJ stricture. Hepatic duct strictures or ductoplasty has been required and anosmic strictures have been formed. So here is one patient we encountered out of a few of these which you have seen. This was the pre-op MRCP. This is a post-op after 2 years, patient having recurrent cholangitis with deranged LFT, and we reoperated this patient. The stoma was just 5 millimeter. We used the whole left duct and did a good hepaticogegastomy. This is another very sad story of a three-year-old child who came to me. I said, I will do a good job for you, but they chose to do a laparoscopic surgery for this. The laparoscopic HJ was done. The child came 3 years later with recurrent cholangitis with this MRCP. We can see clearly that a complete excision has not been done and child is symptomatic. I'll show you the video of this child which was excised and show you some of the critical aspects of redo surgery and what to do proximally. So same child, 4A choledochal cyst, lap excision with Roux-Y HJ done, presented with jaundice and cholangitis. There was obviously a strictured HJ in this. So here you have a Roux loop, so you have to be careful about it. So do a very meticulous, slow, precise anastomosis, identify the Roux loop, be in the right plane. I don't use cautery in this dissection, but get to the right planes, copious irrigation. So basically first step is identify the Roux loop so that it leads you to the point where the HJ has been done. Now you can appreciate here, this is the choledochal cyst. This is the HJ, the Roux loop which has been, duodenum is adherent. And this is the area of the strictured HJ. So we dismantle this. And you can see that, look at the size of the stoma of this in 3 years, what has happened. And this is what happens if you do to the main choledochus. A very small opening on the jejunal orifice and a very small opening on the choledochus. Now, in this, you have to go high up. So under the quadrate lobe or the segment four, expose the hole by lowering the hilar plate, dissect out the choledochal cyst proximally. You have to be careful about the vascular anatomy here because of the adhesions, you may, there's a potential for injury to the hepatic artery. So you should identify that. And we identified it somewhere down here and we are over it now. So this is the dissection of the choledochal cyst, which is going on. Some tissues, post-operative tissues, which were there, post adhesions, which were carefully dissected, looped, and then made sure that there's no vessel in this, and this part has been dissected out. You have to be very slow, precise, and take your time. There's no point being in a hurry in this situation, especially in a redo surgery. You can see at the bottom, you can see the hepatic artery. Once you get that, now you can dissect off the choledochus. You get to the bifurcation of the portal vein down over here. Once you do that, then you transect I generally transect a little lower down and then fashion it based on the anatomy which I see inside. Now, because of recurrent cholangitis, you can see there's a thick wall of the choledochal cyst, which you can see here. Excise this. Then later you can refashion and excise a little bit, which we did in this patient. Then look at all the ducts. Now this, you try to do choledochoscopy, see for any intrahepatic, see you can dilate the membranous strictures in this manner. You can dilate it, probe all the strictures. Then what I like to do is efface the biliary opening so that there is a ductoplasty which is done, and all of these open up in front of you in the segment which you're going to anastomose. So there is no potential for these to collapse. Because you have done a excision of the web, there is no potential for re-stricture formation in this area. So this eversion technique, which we have adopted in doing this, it opens up all this. So you can see that ductoplasty and eversion. And then in this one with a good, basically wall, we did a continuous anastomosis in this. You can see here that the same reloop had to be mobilized, then posterior continuous suturing of the bile duct, and then anastomosis completed. So this is the final suture and the completed hepaticogenic nostril. The last thing, 2 minutes I'll take in malignancy in choledochal cysts. Basically, there is a definite risk of malignancy in choledochal cysts, and varying reports from 2.5% to 30%, and in Japanese registry, it's about 16%. Of course, it is higher when there is only drainage procedure vis-a-vis excision, and risk increases with age, the median age of around 32 years. If there is a non-dilated duct, the primary site of malignancy is gallbladder, and there is a cystic choledochal cyst. The cyst is the primary site of malignancy. So how to prevent it? You need to diagnose choledochal cyst and do a complete excision, both extrahepatic and intrapancreatic. We all realize that there is a at-risk biliary epithelium we are leaving behind. And the philosophy is that based on the surface area which you're leaving behind is related to the risk. This is a presumption. I understand that. But you can do what best you can do. Invariably, the outcome because of delayed recognition is very poor, with a median poor survival being low. And this is a very good meta-analysis in 2018 in British Journal of Surgery, which showed that overall risk was about 10%. Primary about 7% and transformation in about 3.4%, primarily in type 1 and type 4 choledochal cyst. And when you see all of these, you see that the odds ratio for risk of malignancy is higher with drainage procedure as opposed to a cyst excision. This is one of the patients primarily having a choledochal cyst with a malignancy in this, who underwent left hepatectomy, and you could see a polypoidal tumor in the choledochus, which is infiltrating the caudate lobe, and a left hepatectomy with caudate lobe excision was done. So in summary, what I would like to say is that it is being diagnosed. We are diagnosing it better now because of the awareness, good imaging which is available, and emphasis on figuring out a cause of dilated bile duct. The dilemma of dilated bile duct will continue to hide us and hound us. And there are several instances we still debate whether it is just a dilated bile duct versus a choledochal cyst. I talked about the classification and some modifications which may be required so as to prognosticate, and decision-making may help by including the abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union and symptoms. Anatomy is important for critical assessment and planning treatment. Complete excision is a sine qua non for management of choledochal cysts. Complete intrapancreatic removal, a proximal extent with good excision. Take care of the biliary anomalies and vascular anomalies which may be present, and identify and address them. Laparoscopic excision can and may be performed after gaining experience in open and being proficient in laparoscopic advanced procedures. Thank you very much for your patient hearing And thank you once again, Beju, for having me on your fantastic program.
Thank you, Dr. Sadiq Sarim Sikora, for the wonderful webinar. Actually, there were a lot of learning points in it. It was a really a brilliant talk. Now I request Dr. T.D. Yadav to interact with Dr. Sadiq Sarim Sikora.
So, very comprehensive talk, sir, as usual. And Dr. Baiju has already said, and I'm seeing many questions, but I'm not able to read it. But before taking all the questions, I think some points I would like to re-emphasize. As you said, the most important thing is diagnosis, especially when there is a diagnostic dilemma regarding common bile duct dilatation vis-a-vis colorectal cyst, especially when it's not classical, when it is very, the CBD is not very dilated, very classically as it is should be seen in the colorectal, in MR cholangiogram. And second important thing is, the most important is having a very wonderful, nice imaging. And all the residents should learn to read the imaging also. We should not be only believing in the radiologist report, so that you are going and seeing all the anomalies, because as I already said, anomalies are very common, vascular and biliary both. And we have to take care of both the anomalies. So that is also important. And then in the management, there are, I think, three important areas. One is upper end management. Second is the lower end management. And the third one is posteriorly dissection from the portal vein, which is very important. And sometimes accessory or even replaced right hepatic artery, which is behind the choledochus. And if patient has been, which is not very uncommon, that multiple times BRCP has been attempted, and especially when T-tube drainage has been done, and especially when somebody has done some type of bypass procedure like choledochal duodenostomy, and then you are getting that patient symptomatic and going for a re-excision. These are the people where we have a really difficulty. So I would like to start with this. Sadiq sir, what advice you will give when you are having lots of adhesion posteriorly and you are very much worried that there may be a injury to the portal vein? So what message would like to give? And for God forbid, if there is an injury to the some portal vein, then what are the tips to rescue the bad on the table?
Yeah, so I think that's very important. And what I like to do always is, if there is a lot of adhesion in that area, I go medial and at least get an idea of where my portal vein is. I think that's very important. So that once you know where the portal vein is, you are aware that how far to go. Always in choledochal cyst, if there is no malignancy, you can always do the dissection very close to the choledochus. And I remain very close to the choledochus in the medial dissection and also the posterior dissection. And if the adhesions are quite severe, lot of inflammation, especially in patients with recurrent cholangitis, and if they have been stented, there is a significant pericholangitis, then you may adopt the method which has been described. Although, to be very honest, T.D., I have never had to use it till now in all my 20-25 years of surgery. I've not had to do it, which is the lily eye technique, that you do leave a wall of the duct. But the key is to understand that when there is significant inflammation, there is a potential for injury. And if you are careful, if you are close to the bile duct, you may even dissect in the wall of the bile duct and leave behind that, and then get into the nice dissection part, which you will eventually get to, and then do the excision and get up and do that. So you have to be careful. You have to know where your portal vein is and avoid close to it. And if things are difficult, then you may leave a part or portion of the wall on the medial surface and burn the mucosa. If you have an injury, and if you've not been able to identify it and then injury occurs, then it is a very terrible situation, because then you don't have any proximal or distal control. And then to control this in the midst of significant bleeding and inflammation, it is tough. So the time-tested technique of packing, waiting, do a Pringle, get your finger across, close it, and then carefully and very meticulously try to close the rent, unless it has been some massive rent which has been caused by inadvertent, unplanned cut in that area, or a cautery which has been used, presuming it to be duct and it's a portal way.
One more important point, sir. What I found that since when portal vein comes lower down in the towards the duodenum, then it goes little bit toward the left side. So if somebody is making a looping the thing, I think what is your opinion if somebody goes as low as possible while looping to the colidocal cyst? So dissecting in that area rather than going in the middle, or taking the gallbladder down and trying to loop at the upper end, or sometimes, what is your opinion about this?
No, I think, you know, see, in this, what I would say is, don't be stuck. Try to find the best plane which you can with, above or below. And one of the techniques is get the gallbladder out, use it as a traction medially to lift the whole colidocus, and then go dissect posteriorly. Don't go very down to open the foramen of Winslow, but dissect off the tissues so that you're only dissecting the colidocus. And then wherever you find a good plane to try to loop it, you can then do it. So your point is good, that at the lower end, it moves over to the left. You can use that area. But I think just try to dissect and see where best you can find. And once you loop it, then you are much better off to dissect close in that area and just dissect off the colidocus from rest of the tissues.
So one question is always we are seeing in most of the panels, it is asked, and though many times you also might have answered in the meetings. So for the people listening today also, that when you have injured the pancreatic duct on the table, you are able to identify. So how will you manage? So that is the question, though we discuss repeatedly that most of the time we have not seen it. But I find this question repeatedly being asked. So I thought we should clarify in this discussion.
So, I mean, I think we discuss it always.
Yes.
I have not encountered it. Let me start at that. And we've done a lot of colidocal surgeries. I've heard one or two when post-operative pancreatic fistula have been identified in patients, and we've had discussion with some of my colleagues on that and how to do about it. So I think the key is a good preoperative study of the cholangiogram, and if there is an abnormal pancreatic or biliary ductal union, and that will save you with most of the problems. If there is a type B, which is the potential for injury, if it is a type B union, then you have to be careful. In that situation, I open the colidocus at the lower end much earlier than what I would do with a type 1 APBDU. Because there, and also in the cholangiogram, if there is a very clear distinction between the dilated and the narrowed part, then I aim for that. And the union is not in the cystic part. So that is the, you know it pre-op, that how much to go. So the risk remains in the type 2 variety. The type 2 variety, I open the duct much earlier, and then I try to see whether you can locate the opening of the pancreatic duct. To be very honest, you can't most of the time. But you may use a colidocoscope in the lower end to see. And I have not had to do it, but you may be able to identify. And then based on that, you transect at a level wherein you avoid injuring the pancreatic duct and close it very meticulously, not taking very big bites of the lower end. So prevention is the best thing. The second thing I said is that anteromedial side is where you would expect this to be joining. So therefore, be careful in the dissection. So most of your colidocus dissection should happen posterior and lateral. And then once you do that, you keep on seeing how the planes open up and go there. And then based on the cholangiogram, you divide. So generally, identifying on the table will be difficult most of the time. Let me tell you that. So the presentation may be post-operative with a pancreatic fistula. Now in that situation, I think conservative management would be the best thing, as long as it's feasible. Then you may have to do a cholangiogram and see a MR cholangiogram to see what the configuration of the pancreatic duct is. And if it is, you're fortunate, you may be able to stent it. But it is a difficult this thing. Sometimes I have recommended to people that for long period of time, more than 2 to 3 months, if it continues, you can reoperate and would do a kind of a cavity jejunostomy. So just drain that cavity which is there with the fistula into the jejunum, rather than trying to find the duct or anything. That too, give significant time for it to close. It may close with a stricture, and if you are fortunate, it may not close with a stricture. If it closes with a stricture, we deal with the stricture subsequently. If it is a fistula, we can do a sort of cavitojejunostomy and sort of drain the fistula internally. I don't know if you have encountered, I would be happy.
No, I have also not, but I am finding in every conference this question is raised, and I thought we should discuss here also, so that lots of people are logged in and everybody should know, and many of them are DNB and MCH students also, so they can make their answers, and sometimes they can quote you as a speaker when the consultants say something else. So one more important point.
Dr. Tide, yeah. May I ask one question regarding?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah. Some of the cases probably may not be able to, because the child's scenario shown on that already laparoscopy was done, then later cholangitis and this thing. Even the second surgery, I don't think we can go up to the dilatation, which is there in the intrahepatic part. So in that case, would you suggest an access loop for later entry for these patients?
So Beju, I mean, you know, I don't have much faith in access loop anymore now. So to be very honest, in the last 10, 15 years or so, I've not made an access loop. I personally feel access loop, I mean, getting away from the topic a little bit, would be best for recurrent pyogenic cholangitis or intrahepatic stones, where there is a likelihood for recurrent stones, there may be intrahepatic stricture, and if you have access to that, that probably is the best scenario. Beyond that, in biliary strictures and any other hepaticojejunostomy, I don't see much requirement or need for doing an access loop. In scenarios where there are problems with hepaticojejunostomy, then anti-grade approach now with our good interventional radiologists is better than a retrograde approach, is my opinion. I know a few people may still continue to do access loops in some scenarios, but I have more or less given up access loop, except in, I told you, in the recurrent intrahepatic stone scenario.
And because I am doing laparoscopic colorectal excision, I must agree with you regarding the incompleteness of excision. There is a tendency that in laparoscopy, you will not expose the entire thing and you will not be seeing the narrowed part in the intrapancreatic part most of the time. So what you like to do is that you like to cauterize the duodenum and lift the pancreas with the cyst, holding the cyst up, and try to dissect around the lower narrowed end, and then tie it off. Most of the time, people tend to stop the dissection at the upper border of the pancreas. That should be avoided. The point should be well taken from Dr. Sajid Sikora. Over to Dr. T.D.
So one more important point, I think, which is though rare, but it is everything has been discussed. This is again, it's left. Is suppose a patient comes with the portal hypertension, maybe because of the extrahepatic portal vein thrombosis and cavernoma there, arm. This may be because of the multiple use of stent, inflammatory thrombus, or some thrombus which is because of the disease project itself. So how to proceed about this patient?
I think that's a difficult scenario. And I think when we were at SGPGI, there are a couple of cases which we encountered with this, with portal vein thrombosis and all. And it's a difficult scenario. And therein, where the partial cyst excision would be the thing, if it is still feasible, but if there are extensive collaterals, I think that is one scenario wherein I would concede that there is a drainage procedure has some value there. Because that is singular situation with extensive collaterals in that area where you want to deal with the problem at this point of time. And then we see that, you know, long term, whether there is any development of malignancy. So care to dissect if feasible. Otherwise, I would say that maybe a high drainage procedure you may have to do in such situations.
So, Dr. Baiju, I have, I'm not able to see the questions. So, can I see the questions then?
Okay. Yeah, there are a lot of questions actually. Dr. P.K. Reddy is there. He's asking, what is the role of Lilly's procedure? Can you open up,
please? So, I think I briefly mentioned.
Yeah, that was.
I had an occasion to do it, but in case there is significant, like a situation we just discussed, that if there is portal hypertension and it is portal vein thrombosis with significant collaterals and you don't want to dissect very close to the medial side of it, then you may leave behind the wall and then ablate the mucosa or excise the mucosa over it and leaving behind the thick wall. So that is perhaps the singular situation in which one may need to do it if you encounter that.
Yeah. What is the incidence of secondary biliary cirrhosis in the case of recurrent cholangitis in cholecystitis?
So I won't be able to tell you the exact incidence, but I think it is good about 10 to 15% incidence is there. It's coming down now. Earlier, these were not being diagnosed. So I remember about 15, 20 years earlier in our series, which we published, there were patients with secondary biliary cirrhosis. And that's because they were not diagnosed, recurrent stenting or something would be done, or some drainage procedure had been done. And there is underlying cholangitis, which is going on with subclinical obstruction. And then they develop secondary biliary cirrhosis. Now I think that incidence is coming down because we are recognizing this entity. We are resecting, excising this colletocal cyst and doing a good anastomosis. So I think it's coming down.
Can I add, recently, yes, I am seeing more and more strictured, as you emphasized rightly, because of the N2, people tend to do N2 side anastomosis. And from January, only 4 patients we do a redo. And in one of the patients where multiple times PTBD was done and the liver was not very good, we did fibro scan and LSM value was quite significant. So I think this may be one scenario where secondary biliary cirrhosis might be setting in more than a primary colletocal cyst. So once proper job is not done and then people develop this thing and then go to different places to avoid another surgery. And that is, yes.
I think there's a very good point that you make, TD, because I have seen that a couple of redos which we have done.
Yes.
People are very reluctant to have naturally another surgery. And the primary surgeons are also very reluctant to offer another surgery, saying that this will not help. So I think the recurrent cholangitis in this can lead to secondary biliary cirrhosis. I quite agree with you. And we should, because it's a benign condition and it is correctable, unless it is a situation where there is reasons not to reoperate in that situation, you should always reoperate these patients and correct the strictured hepaticogenostomy. I am in sync with you.
Yeah. There's a question from the chat box, Daravid, I think he's from Cambodia. He's asking, how do you treat a complicated cold occult cyst with the biotech stone obstruction, stone clearance ERCP or direct surgery?
So my preference is not to do any intervention if possible. So control cholangitis with antibiotics. If it gets controlled, after control of cholangitis, undertake surgery. If cholangitis is not controlled, it is even leading to abnormal liver function tests and jaundice. In that situation, you may want to do a stenting so as to control cholangitis and then do the definitive procedure at a later date. Okay. You may want to remove the stones, but removal of stones is not the primary objective even of the ERCP. It is basically good drainage. So you should get your stents high up into the right and left ducts to provide good drainage. And if that can be accomplished, it's fine. In the process, if you can remove the stones, fair enough. That will help in controlling the cholangitis. But that's not the primary objective. So that's how I would manage. And then go ahead secondarily for the definitive
system. Dr. Karthikeyan from Tirunelveli is asking, he has got a patient, 70-year-old, asymptomatic cold occult cyst. Will you go ahead with the surgery or wait?
Yeah, I think now we are encountering these scenarios quite often in our clinical practice. As I said, now with good ultrasounds, people are picking up and are more definitive about it. And then we are doing more and more MRs in these patients. And generally this would be 70 year old, asymptomatic, pristine normal liver function test and a dilated bile duct or a colidocal cyst. So I tend to first assess the physiologic assessment of this patient, that how good is it in terms of comorbidities, cardiac evaluation and all. Once I make the assessment, I have a good counseling session with the patient and the relatives. I tell them that you have no symptoms and it is not absolutely essential for you to undergo surgery at this point of time. At this point, we are trying to prevent development of cancer, if at all, as being the only reason for doing a colidocal cyst excision, because you have not had any symptoms as well. And if you are not worried about it or you are okay to come for regular follow-up, we can observe. So I think there is a good enough scenario for observing this group of patients without rushing in to offer surgery to them. Now just twist this to about 55 year old, whether you would offer this. Perhaps I would be more serious in offering this patient a cyst excision, because they still have a 20-25 year life expectancy, which is expected in this. And you never know what may transpire in that. And they are in reasonable good health to be taken up for a colidocal cyst excision with minimal morbidity and no mortality in our hands. So that's how I would deal with this scenario.
Yeah. Dr. Jayapala Reddy Vallega, he's asking, what is the difference between the normal histology of normal histology of biotech and a cold occult cyst?
So I think that's a very interesting question. And to be very honest, because you tell your pathologist that it's a colidocal cyst, they'll invariably write consistent with colidocal cyst. So there is, to be very honest, no definite difference. Oftentimes, because of chronic inflammation, if it is present, there will be obliteration of the normal histology of mucosa in that area. And if that is present, they would say that it is consistent with colidocal cyst.
Okay.
To the first point, this about 70 years, the only I think I also have a patient I am following, but I think, sir, the problem would be one that if suppose we are even after counseling patient develop malignancy, then they might talk different. And if we operate and patient goes had a leak and develop some complication, then again he might say that there was nothing. So I think it's a very tricky situation. As sir said, we have to do a very good counseling and sit with the patient and spend some 20 minutes and then probably take a decision. So that is very important. in that scenario.
If Kripa's dad was there, he was asking a question in the chat box. So he was really his experience doing a policy for Jibunastami. Can you please unmute, sir?
Hello. Hello, sir. How are you?
I'm fine.
Yeah, actually, this is quite some time back, 8 years ago. We had an 18-year-old boy, and there were a lot of additions with the portal vein, and we couldn't separate it. So we were forced to, the cyst was very small, fusiform cyst only. So we did a drainage procedure, and he's under follow-up. So far, there is no problem. So I just wanted to know the expert's opinion, what else can we offer him now?
Yeah, Dr. Sadiq.
Yeah, I mean, if you've done this thing and the patient has been well, no cholangitis, no other symptoms since the drainage procedure, and if imaging right now is good, and how old is the patient now?
He was 18 then, he is now 24.
24. So, I think, I mean, you would be the best person to tell that what was the scenario like, and you would think it would have improved. But I would critically do the imaging, repeat imaging in this patient, maybe do a CT scan and an MR both to assess the pericolitocal status any better. And I would consider a reoperation and excision of this colitocal space in this patient for a good long-term outcome.
Presently, yeah, it's asymptomatic.
I know.
Yes,
this is probably the best time to do it before he develops symptoms and cholangitis. See, generally the drainage procedures don't work. They cause problems over a long period of time. It could be 10 years, it could be 12 years or whatever. It may be cholangitis or it could be a malignancy at a later date. And as a young person, and I would think that it would be worthwhile to offer this patient a re-surgery with a complete excision.
I think I agree with sir. Even as we discussed in the beginning, that if there is lots of adhesion, then probably taking most of the part of the cyst. So if you are forced to leave, you will be leaving very small part. So you can go all around and only maybe thin posterior layer can be left alone. All other part can be excised, opening the cyst. So open the cyst and excise under vision from all around. So that is one way when doing. And at this stage, probably it's very important to re-excise because of the not only cholangitis, because of the fear of malignancy. As we know that malignancy is common in these patients in the long term.
Yeah, Dr. Aparna Deshpande from Bombay has raised his hand. Madam, can you please unmute?
Yes. I have unmuted. Dr. Sadiq, that was an excellent talk. As usual, the last time I've heard you was at Kathmandu for biliary injuries and biliary anastomosis. I just wanted to share, since there was a lot of talk about postoperative pancreatic fistula, and overall I feel the experience with that is really less. I just thought I should share my experience of only one case of the postoperative, thankfully, of postoperative pancreatic fistula. And all the problems that I think we have discussed in the last half an hour were present in that patient. Recurrent cholangitis, a very thick-walled bile duct, extremely inflamed, a lot of adhesion, densely adherent to the portal vein, with an abnormal biliary pancreatic junction. And the bile duct had to be transected midway. So that was the technique that I used, because it was very difficult to delineate the portal vein and get across the bile duct. So after transecting the colitocal cyst, I could hold the posterior wall and then peel the whole thing off. And the whole duct was like a coconut shell. And the lower end was transected, oversewn. Unfortunately, the patient from the second day itself developed a very high output pancreatic fistula, and with a very extreme hemodynamics. So we were forced to consider multiple options. And as you recommended, we tried to do an MRCP. We saw a leak about 2 centimeters from the ampulla. An ERCP was attempted, but a stent couldn't be placed. So we had to perforce go in because he was hemodynamically quite unstable, a very young boy. Fortunately, during the second surgery, we could identify that leak. Then at that time, I used T-seal, again, oversaw the entire thing. But I believe the same procedure was done at the first go also. So I do not know what helped, but thereafter that leak slowly reduced, and conservatively over the next 10 days or so, we settled completely. Fortunately, the hepatico-jejunostomy was excellent and there was no secondary problem because of this leak. And thereafter, he is fine now. This is about 3 years back, and his follow-up MRCP also shows excellent HepJ with very little residue. But it was a nightmare, and I would really like to hear from all the experts, you know, how they manage this particular scenario. I think you already explained that very well, conservative management as far as possible, and sometimes cavity to jejunum anastomosis. But I just thought that since the cases are so limited of postoperative fistulae with such unstable parameters, I thought I should just share that.
Yeah, thank you very much. I mean, excellent. I mean, you managed it and that's good. And I have not managed it, so you are one better than me. So
I think it's a matter of luck from the patient's point of view more than anything.
But I think that's the way to go. I don't know, because you knew the scenario inside, you reoperated and whatever you have to do. So I think that's the way to go. It will be an independent patient by patient decision making, which we'll have to do depending on the situation and scenario. And I mean, you know, at the end of the day, if we sort of are able to manage that patient and we does well, I think that's the way to do, because I don't think there is any experience by which we can say that this is the best way to manage this complication. Yes. It is rare, as you yourself have realized, and in each situation, we will have to figure out what is the best way. So great that you were able to get this patient out. I congratulate you.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, madam. Dr. Yoga has asked a question in the chat, because actually I couldn't understand what is mentioning. Dr. Yoga, are you there? Can you please unmute? And Dr. Deepak also, if he's there, can you please unmute? There are two questions, one by Dr. Deepak and Dr. Yoga.
Sir, I'm Yoganagin, the pediatric surgeon, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, it was a very nice talk. Basically, my main question is actually, sometimes we see as pediatric surgeons, we see in very small newborn periods also. And we take 7 mm as a criteria for dilatation of the pulled up. It's called pulled-up. And my main question is actually how small of a width can we accept to do a proper surgery, and as most where we should not land up in a trouble.
It's a good point, especially when you have a cystic variety of colidocal cysts. The proximal duct is not much dilated. So you will have only the cystic variety, and you excise that, or the A and B type. So in that, it may be a challenge. So we can anastomose any duct. That's not an issue. I think what I have encountered in some of the pediatric children cases which I have done, there are two issues. One is the duct is small, especially if it is a cystic variety. Second is the duct is thin, very thin also in these patients. So the small duct I manage by opening up the left duct. I think that's the key. We have to open up the left duct, spatulate it, so you get a wide stoma. The challenge is thin wall ducts, and it's a nightmare actually at some times. So I have a couple of techniques which I have developed to deal with this thin wall ducts in colidocal cysts specifically. A, we use very fine monofilament. So we use about 6-0 PDS in this double arm needle so that we conveniently take the sutures. The second thing which I do is I stagger my placement of the sutures. So they don't come in a single line along the line of the bile duct, so that the tension is not in one point to tear off the ducts. So you stagger the placement of your sutures a little closer to the margin, a little away from the margin, or closer to the margin, away from the margin. And sometimes what I do is I sort of roll up the duct margin to give it double thickness and take the suture through that. That way, a single thickness duct becomes a double thickness duct, and it gives you a good purchase for the sutures. So with these techniques, because I burnt my fingers at one time, I completed or took all the posterior layer, and then the whole thing like a sliver came in my hand, and it was a nightmare trying to fix that. And then I realized that if you stagger, you double wall them, then at least they hold better, and you'll be able to do a safe hepaticogenostomy.
Yeah, there is a question by Dr. Anand from Trichy regarding the suture material used in cold local cyst in laparoscopy. I must answer the question.
You must answer that.
Yeah,
I usually use a 3-0 PDS, and as you said, if the wall is too thin, you may have to go for 4-0 or 5-0 PDS. So usually PDS is the material, and in routine cases we use 3-0 PDS.
So we also use PDS. Major, we have a few on that.
Yeah. Abhay Darby sir is there in the he does the president of Association of Surgeons of India. He joined late only because he offered me joining. Sir, do you have something to say?
I can only say that the needle is of most importance. You got to select the needle of the correct caliber. It has to be round body needle and should assist you rather than you assisting the needle in doing this anastomosis. So maybe 8 mm needle in a very fine duct that you are trying to do anastomosis will be of help. Suture material, PDS or polypropylene or whatever you use, I think PDS is the suitable material to do it, but it is the needle of importance, which very few PGs or any surgeon realizes unless he really gets into hepatobiliary surgery. So that's my take on it. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Josna Kulkarni is there in the participant list. Madam, can you please unmute? Yeah, madam.
Hello.
Madam.
I must congratulate the speaker. It was an excellent. I don't know how many times I'm going to say that word. Excellent talk. And it comes out of the experience that he has had for the last so many years. So I'm really glad that you arranged this lecture. I do not have any questions. I think most of them have been already covered in the lecture, and plus as well as they have been covered in most of the question answers. So a big thank you for arranging this, and a big thank you to Dr. Sikora for excellent delivery of the lecture. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Anybody from the participant, can you please unmute and ask the questions directly or give your comments? Dr. Alfred from Manipal. Dr. Alfred. I think he is away. Dr. Sudhir was there on the list. Dr. Sudhir, are you there? Yes, left. Anybody who wanted to speak, can you can unmute and.
Dr. Baiju, can I ask one more question?
Please.
Yeah, Dr. Sadiq, I wanted to know about duodenal anastomosis.
many a times, I think in pediatric surgery, they are accepting hepatic duodenostomy. Is that acceptable or is it like an escape route for laparoscopic surgery? I mean, because that is a little easier anastomosis probably than doing a rule. So is it technically and scientifically acceptable for a hepatic duodenostomy?
So my feeling is that it has evolved at a greater speed after the laparoscopy being accepted, especially in a pediatric age group, because it feels that it is easier to oppose this. It is a single anastomosis, and it is in pediatric age group, it lying close to each other, so you could get this. And in majority of pediatric population, majority of cysts are type 1 cysts, and so it is feasible to do this anastomosis in that. I suspect this. I'm not a pediatric surgeon, though I've done a lot of pediatric colorectal cysts, but not laparoscopic. As far as results are concerned, you know, surprisingly, there are comparative results available of HJ versus hepatic duodenostomy, and it seems in short term they are as good as a hepatic duodenostomy. I'm not sure how it would fare in long term in terms of cholangitis and problems due to the reflux of contents if it's a wide anastomosis into the colidocus. So long term results are still questionable. Short term, it's probably as good as that, and it's preferred technique by laparoscopy, I feel, for pediatric surgeons. This is my take on it. I don't know what Baiju feels about this.
Yeah, I agree with you. Doctor, Yoga wanted to make a comment.
Yeah, being a pediatric surgeon, sir, I just wanted to add a comment. I have been doing laparoscopic means hepatic duodenostomies. Yes, definitely it is practical, feasible, and very physiological. That's what we usually commonly say. And of all the cases, actually, only one case, actually, I had liver abscess, which was managed conservatively. So apart from that, actually, we did not face much problems with anastomosing duodenum. And it is very easy and very practical. Yes, laparoscopy, maybe it is an escape route, as Madam said, but it is a very practical and easy approach for pediatric surgeons. We are very comfortable with that.
But in my series, I have not done anastomosis with the duodenum so far.
I think you should try, sir. It's very easy and very, they're just adjacent to each other.
Maybe the difference is in pediatric and adult, because to take the duodenum up, right up to the hilum in an adult may not be feasible in all. And if you want to compromise taking it there, it may be another compromise which we do. But I agree that in pediatric population, I've gone through a lot of literature which they're quite comfortable doing hepatic duodenostomy.
Yeah, especially in laparoscopy, it's very difficult to mobilize duodenum so high up and do the anastomosis. At least in adult people, which we encounter.
Can I make a comment?
Yeah, please. Anil.
Yeah, hi. Dr. Sadek, really enjoyed your talk. It was a pleasure to listen to the, excellent talk and excellent tips. And I think several new things you talked about, which I think is a learning experience for all of us. Just a point about, I wanted to make about hepatic duodenostomy. I mean, because I thought that we tend to do hepatic duodenostomy both for laparoscopic as well as open. And in fact, even for not only colidocal cysts, but at times biliary strictures also. So I think because like what you talked about, even prior to a laparoscopic approach, I think in the pediatric literature, hepatic duodenostomy and Todani series and other some series from Japan, they have been routinely doing hepatic duodenostomy. And as you rightly said, that probably because the duodenum is easily able to reach. So in terms of when you talk about medium-term and long-term results, and especially being done in children, so there is a convincing evidence. Now here the issue is only whether it will come in adults. So I think what we have found, and we are in the process of publishing our experience, that in a large percentage of patients, you are able to get duodenum without tension to do a hepatic duodenostomy, particularly in colidocal cysts. So just I wanted to make that comment. Yes. Thank you.
Actually, I had two cases of redo SCN excision road locus done by open surgery before, but I had to go excise the, as Dr. Sadik was showing the video here, did it laparoscopically. Both the patients are doing extremely well. Any other questions from the floor?
I would like Sadik to comment on that.
Anil, actually, it's news to me that you prefer doing that. I didn't know that. So that's news to me that even for biliary stricture, you are. To be very honest, I've not tried or even thought about it. Now maybe I'll think about it. In biliary stricture, I feel there is so much of inflammation and because of the previous injury and all, I wonder how easy it is to mobilize the duodenum up. But as you said, that you've been able to do in a lot. I think sometimes we are stuck with what we've been doing for a long period of time and something which is not broken. Why would you want to repair it? So that is the thought process in my mind. But maybe I'll give it a thought after listening to you in more detail about the techniques and methods. What I'm talking about is in biliary stricture, when we want to do the anastomosis very high up, in colletocal cysts, when we want to do the anastomosis, is it that every time we'll be able to do, or it will be dependent on if feasible, we do it, otherwise we take that and keep that as an option?
Yeah, not in all cases you'll be able to do, as you rightly said. And in fact, if I was to add that, in fact, we were initially doing more often in laparoscopic. And then we realized that when we are doing it laparoscopic, why not open?
Yeah.
So in fact, nowadays, we would, irrespective of lap or open, try to see if the duodenum can reach without tension. And there are no high-risk factors in terms of leak or, you know, not being able to reach. Like, as you said, that in biliary stricture, in which there is a more difficult situation, we would not like to, like when we have to err in the side, we would err on the side of a hepaticogegenostomy if it was a biliary stricture, which was a kind of a more difficult anastomosis. And similarly, when there are strictures are more likely to cut through in a very thin colletocal cyst, maybe you would prefer to do, or we would prefer to do a hepaticogegenostomy rather than duodenostomy. But I'm just saying that we would not be, you know, keep that as against, and in cases which are suitable, and in cases in which the duodenum is able to reach without much of tension, we would go ahead and do a hepaticoduodenostomy, whether in lap or open. Yeah, thank you.
Your point is well taken, Dr. Anil. Dr. Abhayadal, you wanted to talk.
I just want to say the principal management of a colletocal cyst is getting a good outcome. And what is an outcome? It has to be disease-free survival for a long time, whether pediatric or it is adult. What procedure you want to follow? You do a hepaticodoco-duodenostomy or a jejunostomy. One has to be very, very clear that long-term benefit is there. So let the pediatric surgeons decide, let the adult surgeons decide which is the best one. That's the one which I would like to say, because patient safety is most important. One, you realize a stricture after a colletocal cyst excision and a hepaticodoco-jejunostomy can lead a patient to become biliary crippled. So it's a one-time surgery. Do it properly and stay blessed. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Dr. Paresh Varti wanted to talk something.
Yeah, just I wanted to, this is Paresh Varti. Hi, Sardik. I enjoyed your talk as usual. I just wanted to again elaborate on the role of hepaticojejunostomy versus hepaticoduodenostomy, which we have been doing for so many years. I think one of the concerns most of us always have is that, God forbid, if your hepaticoduodenostomy leaks, then you have a very major problem on hand of a duodenal fistula, unlike a hepaticojejunostomy which leaks, because that is relatively easy to manage and salvage. And that concerned, at least in the adult population, over and above the local inflammation, technical difficulty of reaching the duodenum above, overweighs the thought of doing a hepaticoduodenostomy as a routine in the adults. This is just the comment which I wanted to make.
I agree with you. I agree with you because we want a wide anastomosis. That means we want a wider opening on the duodenum. And if there is a leak, then we are having to deal with a complex problem. So I am with you on that.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Ashwini wanted to know something more about the ductoplasty.
Yeah, I saw some of the questions on that. So, this is something which we have evolved over a period of last 4-5 years, that we have seen that in type 4 variety, there are membranous strictures, there are stenosis, some easily can be taken care of, and each one needs to be dealt with independently. If you miss one, you will have persisting problems in these patients. So what we have started doing in this, all membranous strictures, you can just dilate and they will open up. And most of the time there's not a problem. For a stenosis, you may sometimes have to do an incision and do a ductoplasty in that. Now, what happens is sometimes these ducts are situated way inside and you are worried that the membranous strictures which you have removed come together to form a stricture again. Evert this.
You are just trying to.
You told me that's why I prepared. I asked
so,
you
so about. Put it. I am listening.
You listen. I'm not saying no. Yeah. But you told me that.
Okay. We have eased. So it is a kind of, intramucosal or intraductal sutures, which is a plication kind of suture. From the edge of the ductal opening, I take about 2 or 3 sutures so that it sort of plicates the opening and widens the mouth of the ductal opening so as to have a long-term opening. We'll have to see how this figures over a long period of time with follow-up and we'll know about it. But it is in a quest to keep these stoma or orifices open. We thought that this would be another addition to the armamentarium of how to manage these type 4 colidocalcysts. We often also do a Fogart balloon dilatation even under vision with a colidocoscope or intrahepatic strictures. So all these things we have to do to ensure that each hilar stricture or intrahepatic stricture is taken care of while you're dealing with type 4 colidocalcysts.
Yeah, any more questions from the poll? Dr. Lashmi?
Sir, hello, sir.
Yeah.
Excellent lecture and excellent description of all complications, what can occur. And sir, thank you for a very good presentation, sir. Sadiq and Kennedy.
Thank you, Lashmi, for logging in.
Thank you.
I think we are coming to the end of the meeting. I request Dr. T.D. Yadav to give the conclusion remarks.
So thanks everybody for making this session very interactive. And I have to say nothing more except that we have tried to emphasize all the important points. And again, 2-3 points which are really very important, which make a difference in terms of preventing injury on the table and in terms of preventing the long-term complication. That is, one is that appropriate use of bipolar cautery. Another is that appropriate use of suture material. Another is important is that appropriate taking care of the upper end, appropriate taking care of the lower end, intrahepatic strictures, and in advance, we must read the radiology so that we are sure about the lower end, we are sure about the upper end, we are sure about the anomaly. And because most of these people are very young and they have many years to go, and we should make this surgery safe, and also complications should not be, try to avoid the complication as far as possible. So So I think these are the my comments, and thanks Sadiq sir, and thank Dr. Baiju. I requested you to give me a minute. I just want to say that we are the organizers of Indian chapter of IHPBA 2022 meeting, which is scheduled on 11th, 12th, and 13th February 2022. So I would request everybody to get registered and send the abstracts. That is the my last comment, and thanks once again. Thanks everybody.
Thank you, Dr. T.D. Yadav, and for the speaker for the final conclusion remarks. Dr. Sadhguru.
I can say that it's my privilege to participate in this session. Baiju, thank you very much. And I must congratulate you that you are doing an excellent job with what far and wide this thing is going on, and I wish you all the success in the future. Thank you for having me here, and thank you for everyone for your comments and participation.
Thank you, Dr. Sadiq Sikora and Dr. T.D. Yadav for accepting my invitation, and also thank Dr. Srijaya for introducing the moderator. And also I thank Dr. Abhay Dalvi, Dr. Aparna, and others, Dr. Jasna Kulkarni, others for the interactions. And I thank all the participants who are joined from different parts of the world. And we will meet next week, 8 o'clock, with the tips and tricks of ERCP by Dr. Mohan from Asian Institute of Gastroenterology. Thank you all. Have a good night.
Thank you, Dr. Baiju. Good night. Thank you, sir. Good night.
Night.